Hey everyone, this is TheSighBored. Good morning. For today's video, I'm actually going to take a short ride to balik kampung, or going to ride back to my hometown. It's going to be in Johor, Batu Pahat, Stone Chisel. And to prepare for the ride, right now I'm at the highway entry point. So to prepare for the ride, basically what I've done is just make sure the tires are the correct pressure for straight highway riding, which is for me it's 32 psi on the front and 36 psi at the back. Apart from that, I just did a quick check, make sure that you have enough engine oil and the fuel tank is fully topped up. I've reset the trip meter so that I can monitor the mileage and also how long more I need to go before I need to fuel up again. The journey itself should take roughly, if you're following all the speed limits, it should take like 3.5 hours. I'm gonna try to keep to the speed limits as much as I can, but we'll see. So I'm expecting maybe about 3 hours or less, or depends. I don't really want to get caught in the speed traps and pay fines for no good reason. Money is better off spent somewhere else. As you can see for this setup as well, I'm using a different helmet. This is going to be my Shoei XR1100. But the setup is mostly the same, with the camera mounted on the chin bar, and the microphone is tucked in behind the chin bar. The other thing different for this helmet setup is the microphone is actually practically right in front of my mouth. It's actually touching my mouth at times, so maybe the voice is going to be different or louder, or you hear more breathing. Sorry about that. Why am I not using my K3 helmet and the Shoei instead? The Shoei is going to be lighter. So I'm hoping that for longer distance riding, it's less tiring. The K3 is a bit on the heavy side after you add on the camera and all that. So this is the start of the journey. And we are already breaking the speed limit. Now today is a public holiday. It's Christmas 2014. The roads I don't think are going to be empty. Malaysia is a multi-racial, multicultural country. So those that don't celebrate Christmas actually take the opportunity, the holiday. They actually take it to have their own holiday. They don't celebrate the Christmas, but they just take it as an opportunity to go on a vacation or balik kampung, like what I'm doing right now. I'm expecting some sort of jam or heavy traffic nearer to the Seremban part of the ride. So I'll cut the video for now, and if there's anything interesting, I'll turn it on. So I'll check you guys out later. Time to roll. So right now we are in Nilai. As you can see, weather is pretty good, very cloudy, so it's not going to be hot. The only problem when it's too cloudy is it might rain. I have a couple of, I think it's Z250 bikes in front of me. They are probably, I don't think they are going on long ride. I don't see any baggage with them. Usually this section of the road should start to have some heavy traffic. My guess is maybe it's still a bit too early in the morning for the heavy traffic to start. But I'm glad it's not heavy. It's a pain to filter through traffic because you don't know how the drivers are going to be like. Some are going to be impatient. They want to switch lanes. Alright, continuing on the journey. So I guess I spoke a little too soon earlier. The traffic on the highway is starting to look a bit heavier, and we are just barely into our trip. It's like only about 60 kilos out of the supposedly I think roughly 300 kilo plus. and I mean kilo as in kilometers, not kilograms. The sun is hidden due to the heavy clouds. You can see the part of the sunlight breaking through just in front of us. Very, very nice weather. If only Malaysia had this weather 365 days a week. A week? Fuck that, I mean a year. Alright, back to riding. Catch you guys later. The sun is starting to peek out from the behind the clouds. You can see some sunlight shining onto the road. The road itself, if you look towards my right hand, you can see the lane is actually damp. The surface is damp. Probably, maybe because it's still early in the morning and the road is cold, or it rained last night. That's why I choose to stick on the center lane. The center part here, you can see the differences in the color of the surface. So it's dry on this part, and I prefer to stick on the dry part of the road rather than the wet. If you have a look at the speed, I am going roughly at the speed limit right now. Just taking a relaxed ride. I'm not in a rush to reach my destination. Alright, so for this part of the journey, it looks like there's a slight drizzle going on. Just making sure the lens is clear, there's no bug splatter on it. The road is wet, the rain is not too heavy, just a minor drizzle. I'm going at 162 at the moment. As long as the rain is not too heavy, the ride should be just fine. Once again, I'm not sure how the audio is going to be like. This is a new setup on the Showy. I haven't tested it out. This part of the journey, the rain seems to start and stop at certain areas, but the road is generally wet and the cars that pass through are kicking up all the water up from the road. So there's a slight mist or a lot of water spray if you follow too closely behind the vehicle in front of you. When riding on the highway, just check it out. The rain has just started pouring over this section of the road. Anyway, when riding on the highway, in the lane itself, I try not to stick to the right in the center of the lane. My reason is that if any cars have oil spills or leaking engine oil, stuff like that, the oil will generally leak on the center of the lane because they are riding. I mean, you can see the car in front of me and you can estimate where an oil leak will happen. It'll be on the center. I generally try to stick to the left part of the lane, like where I am right now, compared to the right part, which is near the railing. These guardrails are a big hazard to bikers in case of anything, should you fall or anything like that. That's why I try to keep away. If you think it's not the correct way or you got a different opinion, you can just share your thoughts and opinion. Maybe you got a better point. It's always good to share. But like I said, I prefer to stick on the left part of the lane. Since I don't like to be on the center, you never know if there's an oil spill right on the center part of the lane. Alright, the ride has been slowed down. I need to do some filtering, so I'll catch you guys back later. Hopefully the weather up ahead is much better than right now. A bit more on the weather. Well, before the ride yesterday, I actually did a quick check on the weather forecast for the few places that I'll be passing through. They all said that it will be cloudy. There will be a chance of rain. But mostly in the afternoon, it will start. There will be definite rain in the afternoon. I guess I'm not that lucky to avoid the rain. But it looks like in front, the skies are a bit clearer. So the weather should be better ahead. I should have time to dry off. Right now, I'm not actually in my leather getup. This is my touring getup, which is some sort of textile material and riding pants. This is designed to be fast drying. So if you ride out the further in front, if it's dry and you ride, the wind passing through the body or around you should get the gear dry. The only thing is the leather gloves. It won't dry as fast, but it's for safety. Well, sure enough, the sun is out. You can probably check it out. Yep, the sun is out, but the roads are still a bit damp. Things are looking up right now. Further in front, I'm guessing the road should be all dry. I'll have a chance to dry off. The bike will have a chance to dry off. And we have a chance to maybe ride a little harder. But the main thing is to ride within your limits to be safe. So right now we can see the highway has filtered down to just a two-lane highway. What this means is that there's going to be more cars that are suddenly deciding to switch lanes while you're on the center splitting lanes. Got to be a bit more careful than a three-lane highway. I've just passed by the Pago exit. No, I did not miss the exit. After doing some thinking, I decided to instead exit at Yongpeng. The reason for that is because I wanted to add some extra mileage on the bike so that I can get my bike service when I return back to the city. We will be stopping at the R&R Pago for fuel. Right now I'm clocking almost 200 kilometers on the trip meter with a full tank of fuel, and the fuel light hasn't blinked yet. So it's pretty, I'll say the fuel consumption is pretty good for a sport bike. The average speed, I would say I was cruising maybe around 150 more or less. Hopefully I didn't pass through any speed traps. Okay, we are about to approach the R&R, rest and relax I guess. It's going to be a pit stop for me, a fuel stop. Some would think that a fuel stop is quite a safe place. Fellow biker, I think he's waiting for a friend or something like that. So anyway, where was I? Alright, so fuel stops. You will think it will be a good place, a safe place to stop and rest. Well, fuel stops actually can be dangerous, especially if you're a biker. What you want to be is fully aware of the happenings around you. And while you're filling up with fuel, which I'll be doing shortly, you should be aware if there is anyone coming close to you, some stranger, for no reason, either from the back or in front of you. The reason for that is because you never know if someone just wants to mug you, rob you, or just steal your bike, stuff like that. So you need to be always aware. Don't be the victim. You also want to make sure if you're going to go for a break, to take a shit or take a piss, make sure your bike is secure. There are cases of bike theft, even when you just went out to just take a piss. Fuel, okay. I'll be going for BHP. If you seen my vlog about fuel stations, BHP will be my number one choice, and that's where I'll be going. And I guess I'll just take a short break. Chill for maybe a few minutes before continuing off. As expected, it's pretty packed. Everyone is traveling. It's a public holiday. We are done with our fuel stop. Rested a bit. Oh, shoulders. Okay. Clean the visor for all the bugs splatter. There's not much of a distance left to go. Let me see. So, in terms of fuel, I fueled 13 liters and we got 202, almost 203 km. Let me reset it. Okay, full tank back to zero. Shouldn't be much left. a group of bikers just pulled up, but I don't think I'll be hanging around. The rain cloud seems to be coming. Okay, let's continue the journey. Alright, we are exiting the highway, North-South Highway. This is the Yongping exit. Now, I'm actually heading to Batu Pahat, or in English, direct translation, Stone Chisel. I'm exiting at Yongping because there isn't a direct exit to where I want to go. I could have exited through, Pago, but I decided not to, and I'm gonna skip their so-called bike lane thingy. Alright, so I'm done with that, and we are going into trunk roads now. Batu Pahat, Parit Sulong. Okay, trunk roads are gonna be a bit more tricky. Cars coming in, cars going out, stopping suddenly, doing U-turns. You know, the general bullshit that you need to deal with. You can speed if you want to, but I'm not going to speed. Like I said, I'm not in a rush to go anywhere. And I'm practically almost there. It's just like maybe another like 15 minutes, 20 minutes before I arrive. There's no dedicated road, so for trunk roads you need to do overtakings, plan your overtakings. Bit more challenging, especially if you're already used to city, big city riding, and the roads are all separated by the direction, there's only one-way traffic, something like that, with a divider in the center. No such things over here. You gotta plan your overtakes, make sure you don't overtake in blind corners or up the hill, at the hilltop where you can't see the oncoming vehicles. If it's clear, you can just guess it, come back in safely. Blind corner, the incoming car. Some of the cars will go a bit to the road shoulder to give you way, because there's a road shoulder over here, which is good, but some just wouldn't give a fuck. Typical. It's not only your own self you need to be careful with, you need to expect other people to suddenly overtake in blind corners, to be overtaking at the top of the hill, so you need to be always ready. Ready to avoid, ready to stop. Here we are in Batu Pahat. This should be the town center. On my right is the summit, Batu Pahat. Alright, Batu Pahat. What's cool about Batu Pahat? I'm not a travel guide, I can't really give you much info on that. What I can say though is that Batu Pahat has a lot of these Suzuki V100s, or maybe other countries they call it the Suzuki Address 100. Alright, so that's very cool. It's actually, that bike is actually my first bike. My first ever bike was a Suzuki V100. I'm not sure if it's still in production. I think so, but in Malaysia it's not sold anymore. But there's still plenty of these V100s scooting about in Batu Pahat, which is cool. Got the police quarters, you got a Chinese temple, Buddhist temple. Okay, this is the Batu Pahat Square. I think there's a lot of tents set up right now. There's something going on, some carnival or what. But if you can see at the top, there's this monument of a pair of hands chiseling the stone. So yep, it's a direct translation, Batu Pahat, stone chiseling. Okay, the city is pretty standard. I'm sorry, the town is pretty standard. Most of the roads are single direction, so you tend to loop by the block, one block. If you need to go somewhere else, you need to do the loop kind of thing if you want to enter the other path. And check out this bright pink Nissan March. It's a weekend, so it's gonna be busier than usual. People are going back to their hometowns, and some of the city folk from KL, they actually hail from this part of town, so they are back here. I guess that's about it for Batu Pahat. I'm not sure if I can show you anything else that's interesting. Like I said, I'm not a travel guide. This is the more happening part of Batu Pahat. I think at night, the night scene is around here, I think. And that's about it for this short Balik Kampung trip. I'll catch you guys soon. Ride safe, safe ride, and Merry Christmas! Hey everyone, good morning. This is TheSighBored. Vacation is over, it's time to head back to the city. I'm still at Batu Pahat right now, about to make my way back to KL. Got some sad news yesterday. One of our fellow bikers passed away in a motorcycle accident. I'm not going to say who the person is out of respect, but it's always sad when you find out that a fellow biker and friend passed away. So this is just a reminder for all you guys out there to ride safe and safe ride. For this journey, I checked on the weather forecast as usual. So far in Batu Pahat, the weather is looking fine, but towards Malacca and USJ Subang, the weather is 50-50. It might rain along the way, that is to be expected. Apart from that, the Christmas is over, the next celebration will be New Year. And for that, I expect to have some heavy traffic again. People finish their Christmas holidays, getting back to the city. So hopefully there won't be too much of a heavy traffic on the highway later. We can filter through traffic, shouldn't be a problem. But it's always an added danger when you have to weave through other traffics. My first item of the day will be to get some fuel, but it's not urgent. I still have maybe roughly 140 km on the tank before I need to hunt for a fuel station. But if I do see any fuel stops, especially Caltex or BHP, I'll definitely make a stop and get that sorted out. Peace of mind while you're riding on the highway. Otherwise, I might just stop at the Pago R&R. Should be enough mileage to reach there. Alright guys, I'll catch you guys a bit later when I'm if I do have anything interesting to show, I guess. Alright. Once again, before starting off on the journey, what I did was just check the tires, make sure that there's no loss of air that might indicate that there might be a puncture or an tire issue. Also, just made sure the chain was so right, and also the engine oil was in proper levels with no signs of leaking anywhere. Everything is checking out good, so it should be a pretty straightforward ride back home, back to work. Yep. I'll get back to you shortly if there's anything interesting, like I mentioned. I'm not going to this Caltex because there isn't a credit card at the pump. I normally fill up using credit card because I like to fill it up all the way to the top, and I don't know how much that costs usually. And going to the counter is kind of tedious to me. That's why I'm skipping that Caltex. But I'm pretty sure there'll be plenty more fuel stops, fuel stations further up ahead. Nice weather for riding. Sun's out, roads are dry. During my trip back to my hometown, what I forgot to do was to actually put on some earplugs. I did bring them along, but I just forgot to put them on. So that was not a very good idea, which I found out later after the ride or during my fuel stop. You do have some ringing in your ears. It feels like you got a minor headache going on. After you stop and everything's quiet, you'll feel some ringing sensation, just like maybe if you've been clubbing or standing too close to the speakers. So having earplugs is always advisable, especially if you have a noisy exhaust. Noisy exhaust sounds good in the city when you're, you know, accelerating or short bursts of acceleration or short rides about. But if you're going for long distance and maintaining high speed at a long period of time, I don't recommend that unless you don't mind getting deaf. So always bring along your earplugs and wear them if you remember. For this return ride, I'm definitely putting on my earplugs. Even in fact, I have my earplugs on right now, and it's totally peaceful. And at least I'm not going to go deaf later when I stop for a fuel stop or something like that. Now, wearing earplugs. Some say that wearing earplugs is dangerous because with the earplugs on, you are sort of disconnected from the outside world. Your hearing is impaired, stuff like that. In a way, what they say is correct. Of course, your the amount of noise or sounds that you can hear is affected. You hear a bit less of it, but it doesn't mean that you will totally be deaf to everything. Now, earplugs, it functions to actually cut down noise of a certain decibel. It's not like it's a mute button on your CD player or MP3 player. Okay, so you still get the, like, if you're talking to someone, you can actually still hear them pretty good. It's just that the outside noise, or maybe with your exhaust rumbling noise, it actually cuts out that noise, that kind of decibels. So I don't think earplugs are a bad thing. In fact, it's actually good, like I said, for long rides. It actually makes you less fatigued. You won't get a headache. It doesn't matter if you're wearing the most expensive helmet in the world. Having earplugs is always a plus point for long distance travels. Even racers wearing their top end helmets, you see them wear earplugs as well, because their bikes run way louder, and they actually cherish their hearing. They don't want to go deaf by the age of 30, for example. So earplugs are definitely having more pros than cons. And if you don't have a pair of earplugs, you should go and invest in a pair. They're not expensive to get, so there's no reason not to get one. And also, you need to be a bit, a bit diligent in using them. Like for my case, I had them on. I had them with me, but I forgot about it to put them on, and so I got a bit deaf during the ride back home. One of the things that I dislike most about riding long distance, or riding in particular, I know you're going to call me a whiny little bitch, but let me do my bitch fit just for a moment here. As I was saying, one of the most annoying things to me will be bug splatter or insects hitting your visor and bike, so what. I'm not sure what's going on with insects. You can drive cars and it's not that apparent on cars where the bugs hit the windscreen. They still do, but it looks like whenever they see a bike coming, it's like a suicide bone activated. They will just target your visor and try to splatter all over your visor, your helmet, which is fucking annoying, especially on the visor, because after that you can't see clearly. And if you try to wipe it off, their bug juices will actually blur the visor even more. So it's better to just leave it alone until you can find a proper place to get those disgusting guts, bug insect guts out of the visor. So yeah, that would be one of my top items on my whiny little bitch fit list for riding. That would be insects. I'm not sure, maybe they see a biker coming, they see a nice clean visor, and to them it's like, oh baby, it's time to die, it's a good day to die. I don't know. But that's a part of being a biker, I guess. You gotta just deal with it. Yes sir, what are you trying to do? Alright, thank you. So, let's see, bike lane. Okay, we are entering the about to enter the highway right now. This would be the North-South Highway. It goes all the way to Penang and further up to Perlis, right till the edge of Malaysia. Kuala Lumpur. Let's get it on. So this North-South Highway actually ends right at the border of Malaysia, which is in Perlis, the border between Perlis and Thailand. That was the route I used to go into Thailand on my other ride video. Nothing special about the ride, just a straight road for about, I can't remember, I think it was about 3 to 4 hours. Just a straight highway. So far, looking ahead, the weather seems okay. Not looking too gloomy, just cloudy. Hopefully everything will be nice and clear, and most importantly dry all the way back home. Estimated travel time will be roughly about 3 hours, depending on my average speed and also the traffic. And also hopefully no speed traps. Fuck speed traps. Okay guys, I'll catch you later. And again, I apologize for the audio if it sounds a little weird than usual. I'm using a different helmet. And I didn't actually check my earlier video on the way down to my hometown. I didn't actually check those videos. Too busy just chilling out. So I'll catch you guys later. When you're riding on a long straight highway for a long period of time, your thoughts might generally wander off. You know, you might be thinking about something, or your gaze is trailing off towards the horizon, towards the scenery, stuff like that. If you are traveling at about like 160, 170 kilometers an hour, it's not a good idea to let your mind wander off too far. You might get caught up in a bad situation really fast. It's a different case if you're like cruising at 60 and your mind is wandering off. It's still dangerous, but at least you have more time to slow down, or shorter time to slow down or avoid any obstacles, things like that. For high-speed cruising for a sport bike, I find that the ideal way for me to cruise comfortably is to actually crouch forward in a racing position, but not a full cup. And my elbows are actually on my knees when I do this, so that my hands are less fatigued, because they are resting on my knees. It serves as a resting point for my arms. It also lets you have less wind resistance, so cruising at high speeds, you won't feel all the wind hitting your head, hitting your body, pushing you all about, especially the crosswinds. That's why I feel that using a sport bike to cruise fast on straight roads is actually more relaxing than a naked bike, although you have the upright position or less aggressive naked riding position, not a touring position, but you still have to deal with all the wind hitting your body, your arms, your neck, your head. So all those will make you tired and you will end up more fatigued when you reach your destination. I haven't ridden a touring bike for long distance, so I can't comment on touring. A lot of them claim that the straight up position is comfortable and whatnot, but I still feel that you will have some amount of wind hitting your legs and maybe your arms, no matter how big your windscreen is. So I don't know, man. If you got a different opinion, just feel free to share it. The other thing is that the sport bike engine rides so smoothly at high speeds that you don't feel too much vibrations when you're riding fast compared to like a naked bike. As you can see right now, I'm already at 10,000 RPM, cruising at 165 kilometers per hour, and it's only 10. I can go all the way up to 16 before the red line or the red zone at 17, 18, all the way to 20. So this is basically just, for me, it's like the half point of the engine's full rev. For a naked bike, it will be 6,000, if I'm not mistaken, 5 or 6,000, where your red line starts at about 11 onwards, 11,000 revs. That's what I mean. So that's why I feel that the sport bike can cruise on higher speeds comfortably, more comfortably than a naked bike. I should be exiting soon at Fargo R&R for a fuel stop. And that should be the only fuel stop I need, if I'm not mistaken. So far the traffic has been not too bad. It's not clear where I can maintain a fixed speed. I need to slow down and speed up at places. I think it's better than having a full standstill traffic which you have to slowly weave through. I'll catch you guys after the fill up. So we have some couple of Singaporean bikers. Yep, FDF is Singapore plate. I think that's a Harley. I'm not so sure. Oh, that's a Triumph. So that's a foreigner from Singapore coming into Malaysia, I guess for the for a holiday, New Year holiday, something like that. We get a lot of Singaporean bikers and cars coming in to Malaysia. I did actually go to Singapore during my short stay back in the hometown, and it was a nightmare. Customs at Singapore entering and exiting was a total nightmare. I had to wait like more than an hour just to clear customs with no baggage or anything at all, just went in for a quick tour around the city and skipped out of Singapore. But the customs clearance and the checkpoint was fucking insane. So if you plan to go to Singapore or exit Singapore, try not to do it on the weekend. Maybe some odd hour should be better for you. It was a fucking waste of time at the customs checkpoint, both in and out. Alright, we are at Pago R&R and they have PHP. Fucking awesome. PHP is my number one choice for fuel and that is what I shall fill. Looking for a pump. I'll be putting RON 97 as usual. Alright, so we just filled up petrol. I put in about 8.5 liters and I got 140 km for that amount of fuel. Not too bad. This is not going to be a rest stop, just splash of fuel and we should be good to go. No need to rest or take a piss or shit. Alright then, let's continue the journey. Roadkill. That was an iguana. Or a monitor lizard, whatever you call it. Nasty, nasty stuff. So we're continuing our journey back to KL on Subang. I'm not expecting any troubles or anything or much to report. This is a solo ride after all. There's nothing to see apart from cars. But if I find anything interesting, I'll try to get it on video for you guys. Catch you guys later. Here we are at the Seremban exit for Dixon. Now, I was expecting this area to be jam-packed with vehicles on the highway, but it looks like traffic is smooth, traffic is fine. Maybe it's a bit early, not really, it's already almost 11:30 in the morning. So I guess my assumption or expectations was totally wrong. I'm glad that I'm wrong, because that means a smooth ride. It shouldn't be too long more to reach back home. I think that should be it. I'll just give you guys an update when I'm almost reaching my exit, which is gonna be the USJ exit. This is something you don't see every day, a caravan. Look at the plate, I think it's from France. That's yeah, you don't see caravans here in Malaysia. It's a very seldom thing to see. And it's also a left-hand drive. Cool. Now, due to the road works that are going on over here, the lanes are much narrower than what they they should be. So lane splitting is a bit more dangerous because there's a little less space to lane split than you normally have. Also, the sky over here is looking much cloudy than earlier. I guess it might rain probably later in the evening or the afternoon. If all goes well, I should be back home before the rain starts. Hopefully, we'll see about that. Pressing on. I'm about to reach my exit point from the highway, which is not very far from where I stay. This is, I guess this is about it for our ride, balik kampung ride, or ride back to the hometown. It's not nothing special about the ride. It's just a routine ride. It's not something fancy or something awesome like the long way round type of ride by Ian McGregor and his other riding buddy, where they travel to different countries and stuff like that. This is a simple ride, but this is a real ride. As in, this kind of rides are the kind of rides that people do maybe every week or every twice a week, twice once a month, this kind of ride. Because sometimes having a bike is the only transport, and that's what they use for work and for going back to see their families and stuff like that. Rides for like 3 hours or between 3 to 6 hours, these are the kind of normal rides that people do more often than the kind of rides that you cross multiple borders, multiple countries, go off-roading, stuff like that. Those are more of a touring adventure kind of experience rides. Whereas this type of rides are the rides that people do daily. Like I said, they do frequently and it's normal for them to travel like this. So with that being said, I'll wrap it up with a ride safe, safe ride. USJ, hell yeah! And also the weather looks to be... The rain clouds are looking to be approaching, but I should be safe, nice and safe when I reach home before the rain comes. Okay, enough of my ramblings. Ride safe, safe ride, guys.